The Army Staff, our Chair General A.K. Singh, ladies and gentlemen. At the outset, I'd like to thank General Ahluwalia, Director Claus, and his team for having invited me to this morning session and given me the opportunity to interact with an august intellectual gathering that I see in front of me. I've been asked to speak on the global nuclear environment, to include the impact of technology inductors like hypersonics, cyber, robotics, and finally on tactical nuclear weapons. A very large canvas for about 20 minutes. So what I intend doing is to cover basically three points. Firstly, the doctrine, the concept of employment of nuclear weapons by the 9 nuclear weapon states. Very broadly touch upon the modernization part of it and the implications of the modernization that has taken place. After that, I shall also touch upon tactical nuclear weapons, which I have been asked to do, and in the context of India and Pakistan. I'll try and go fast. It'll basically be skimming the surface, and after that, I'd love to answer questions, if any. Now, Asia is among the most nuclearized zones in the world. Sitting here, 7 of the nuclear powers of the world are in the vicinity. We start with India, with China, Pakistan on either side. You have Russia, Israel, North Korea, and finally the United States also in the area because of its extended responsibilities. So that leaves just France and the United Kingdom. I shall try and touch upon each of these one by one, starting off with USA first. The United States of America, with the maximum number of nuclear weapons, went nuclear with the Trinity test in July 1945. Today, a majority of its infrastructure is over 40 years old. In fact, 25% of the infrastructure dates back to the Manhattan era. Weapons and launch systems of the United States go back to the early 80s, and therefore, to keep abreast of the technological and the physical developments in the rest of the nuclear countries, it is but natural that USA has to modernize. Modernization started a number of years back, and as per CIPRI, approximately $1 trillion have been allotted for this, up to the figure of 2040 approximately. It's a very expensive debt. But that includes changing of the Ohio-class submarines, the SSBNs, to the Columbia-class by the early 40s. A lot of modernization has already taken place, which is in the field of, one, command and control systems, infrastructure, launch systems, and the warhead itself. At the face of it, it sounds very simplistic. But when you go into details, there's an article by Dr. Hans Christensen of the Bulletin of Atomic Scientists. It's an article. It says that although the modernization has been because of keeping the stockpiles safe and secure as per what is called the stockpile stewardship program, but actually it is much more than that. The weapons have grown from the first generation to the fourth generation, which basically implies that, one, they are at least 3 to 5 times more potent. Secondly, they are more accurate. And with induction of things like what is classically called a superfuse, even a missile launched from an SSBN is capable of taking on hard targets. What it implies in simple words is that the entire arsenal is capable of destroying an enemy's nuclear weapon status in a first strike. So this arsenal that we're now talking about of the United States is capable of going in for a first strike to destroy any country's nuclear arsenal. It therefore leads to insecurity, it therefore leads to a strategic imbalance, and therefore it leads to an armed race. Now, very broadly, the role of nuclear weapons, which has been brought out in the NPR, or the Nuclear Policy Review of 2018, which was published, it's an official document, signed by the then Secretary of Defense, James Mattis. The role of nuclear weapons, as in brought out in the preface, is very short. One is to prevent anybody from using nuclear weapons against the United States. Second is to deter a large-scale conventional war with any nuclear-armed state. This document also lists out the necessity of having a flexible response capability, which, when translated, lists out the requirement of having low-yield nuclear weapons. This is something new, because there is a contradiction in the entire setup when I come to it a little later. The requirement of using low-yield nuclear weapons has already been put into effect. As of last month, as per Open Sources report, one of the SSBNs on Operational Protocol was already equipped with a 5-kiloton nuclear weapon. Now, there has been a lot of debates, and including criticism, within the US establishment on this particular thing, because everybody feels that in nuclear parlance, there is no such thing as limited nuclear war. A limited nuclear war very quickly escalates into strategic, and finally you have a strategic nuclear exchange. In fact, one of the CNMO senators in the United States is Diane Flintstone. She's in the 80s. She's been there for since, I think, 1992. She's one person who's fighting for this cause, and she feels that a limited war, even to discuss, is incorrect and impractical. In the NPR 2018, there is a special paragraph on strategy against Russia and strategy against China. In that, it says that in case China and Russia decide to use limited nuclear weapons against America, they would be subjected to incalculable damage. Now, what exactly are they saying? They're saying if Russia and China use limited weapons, they will be subjected to incalculable damage. But on the other hand, if you use a 5-kiloton weapon against somebody else, I suppose the reaction would be the same. So this is what a lot of people in the United States are also saying, that there is no question of a limited war. Any war with nuclear weapons becomes strategic. Even in India, when I come to India, we're saying the same thing. If we are faced with a situation of somebody using tactical nuclear weapons against us, we cannot get into a stone-throwing kind of a thing with tactical nuclear weapons. Our answer is very clear: massive retaliation to inflict unacceptable damage. This is what the Americans are also saying. With this, I jump to Russia. Russia became nuclear in 1949. Developed a triad by the 1960s, and modernization has been on since the 70s and the 80s. Modernization in Russia has been pretty fast. A few of the weapon systems that we have, he spoke about hypersonics. They have the HGV, or the hypersonic glide vehicle. They're also, which I think has already been inducted in very small numbers. This is what the president spoke in October 18. That two or three of these have already been inducted into the Russian nuclear forces. They're also going in for underwater drones, nuclear powered, which could go down to 1,000 meters, range about 10,000 kilometers. The possibilities are unlimited. They're also talking of nuclear powered cruise missiles, but all these are under development. A word about the hypersonic weapon. He just mentioned about the hypersonic weapons. Incidentally, the Americans have been working on this for a while. They've still not inducted it. But for them, the priority is to work on hypersonic weapons for conventional operations and not for nuclear. Now, what exactly is an HGV? It is a missile mounted on another ballistic missile, which at some stage in the flight path, it delinks and goes on its own. A normal ICBM, a ballistic missile, the path is a determined path. So it can be intercepted, and the basic missile defense can take it on. But with a hypersonic glide vehicle mounted on it, the speeds of this vehicle go up to over 20 to 26 max. And it can maneuver itself. Therefore, it is capable of beating any ballistic missile defense. The Russians talk, sorry, the Americans say that this weapon gives Russia a first strike capability, which is quite right. But the Russians say that this is not for first strike capability. This enables us for a credible second strike when it comes to it. So this discussion can go on, but the fact is that the weapon exists. What exactly does it mean for Russia, America, and the others? Like was brought out, this is a very expensive weapon. It's a niche capability that the people have got. In fact, even the Chinese are now saying that they have a similar weapon system. Firstly, the numbers will be very few. And secondly, you already have missiles, ICBMs, or the MIRVs, as they call them, multi-reentry vehicles, or a missile with multiple warheads, which are capable of beating a ballistic missile defense. So therefore, it really does not make much of a difference if you induct a few of these hypersonic vehicles into your defense industry inventory. At the face of it looks that this would create a strategic imbalance, but actually the effect is the opposite. The Russians and the Chinese feel that the United States has a better ballistic missile defense capability. And therefore, if they have something which can penetrate that, it creates a situation of mutual vulnerability between the Americans and the Russians. And this status of mutual vulnerability leads to a strategic balance and not an imbalance. So therefore, as long as each of them feel vulnerable because of the weapons with the other guy, it will lead to strategic balance. A word about Russia's nuclear doctrine. USSR was no first use. Gradually, when Russia was formed, it came down to first use. In 1999, the then chief of the Russian nuclear forces, in one of his talks, spoke about escalate to de-escalate. Now, there is nothing official in any doctrine about escalate to de-escalate, but this was only mentioned once. However, the NPR quotes an escalate to de-escalate doctrine of the Russians, which has been challenged by a number of Americans also, and which, as per official Russia, what they say is not really correct. President Putin in 2018 spoke twice about the nuclear status. It says, "There is no provision for preventive strike. Our concept is based on retaliatory, reciprocal counter-strike. And any counter-strike," they said, "should also be avoided because nuclear weapons can only result in catastrophe." I now quickly switch to China. China aims to be a global power by 2049. And for it, military strength goes on is along with development. And therefore, they've been concentrating both on the nuclear strength as well as conventional strength. China has gone in for missiles, which are the longest range in the world, the ICBM, the DF-41, 14,000 kilometers. They also claim to have the capability of an HGV or the hypersonic glide vehicle. It was showcased in the parade last year, and possibly they also have one. But China's doctrine is of no first use. Their white paper clearly states that China will not use nuclear weapons first under any circumstances. And therefore, this leads to strategic stability as compared to India or any other country. However, there is one problem with the Chinese doctrine. Their ballistic missiles are for dual use. So therefore, when they launch a missile, it is not very clear whether it would have a conventional warhead or a nuclear warhead. And therefore, for countries like the USA, where they have a system of launch on warning, there could be a state of miscalculation, and you could launch a nuclear weapon even if the Chinese were launching a conventional weapon. So this is something that we've got to take care of. I'll not touch upon France, UK, and the other two. Modernization is taking place in all these also. The only difference of the others and France is that France, before it fires a nuclear barrage or massive retaliation, it fires one warning missile. That is to say that now my vital interests are being threatened, I am firing a warning missile. After that, it would be massive retaliation. A word about command and control, etc., what I had been asked to cover. Now, gentlemen, it appears that with cyber threats coming in, artificial intelligence coming in, etc., the command and control networks will be targeted. Yes, they will. Now, command and control consists of two portions. One is the people in the nuclear command authority, the people who decide as to what has to be done, and second are the systems through which the orders are passed from the nuclear command authority to the people who are launching the weapons. Both are equally important, but all I'd like to say here is that whether it's change in technology, whether it's physical destruction, all this has to be catered for if you are a no first use power like us, or if anybody goes on a first strike, there is a possibility of your nuclear command authority being written off, there's a possibility of the people who have to decide would be killed, there's a possibility of your communications going down. Therefore, at the initial stages, you have to have backups and backups and further backups. Because any nuclear country has to be very clear that there should be no stage or no state where your command and control is not functional, whether in terms of the people who are giving the orders or whether in terms of the communications which will pass these orders to the missile launchers. As also the AI coming in, a lot of questions come up as to how would the decision process move. I like to say here is that the decision process with artificial intelligence and other such tools to help you out will only help you to give in more inputs. You cannot leave the decision to launch to a machine. Irrespective of the amount of artificial intelligence or the technologies going up, what I would feel is that the final decision to launch has to rest with the head of state or the political head, because it has to be his decision. We cannot leave it to a machine. I now quickly jump to tactical nuclear weapons, because I find there's just 3 minutes or 4 minutes to go. Now, what are tactical nuclear weapons? Tactical nuclear weapons are those which are used in the TBA or the tactical battle area, which will affect the conduct of actual battles. There is nothing specified in the yield or the amount of casualties that a tactical nuclear weapon would cause. In fact, the existing B-61 gravity bombs, which the US has deployed in a few countries, they are tunable weapons from sub-kiloton to 300 kilotons. The new B-12, at the B-61-12, the new gravity bomb, that goes from about 0.3 to 50 kilotons. So when we talk of TNWs, it's not a 0.2 or 0.3, it could be any amount, but it affects the battle actually. Coming down to the India-Pakistan equation, the Indian nuclear weapons are meant to deter any country from using nuclear weapons against us, whereas the Pakistani nuclear weapons are purely anti-India. Second, the Pakistani nuclear arsenal has been made with help from a lot of other people. I call it as an Indian as a beg, borrow, steal program. The Indian program is more or less indigenous. I have amongst us Dr. Vasudeva, who's one of my colleagues at where I work now. He's been part of the team which has done the 1974 and the 1998 explosions. So in the question answers, we'll request him to take it on also. But when it comes to the use of tactical nuclear weapons, Huda had covered about planning conventional operations. I look at it a little differently. Pakistan talks using nuclear weapons even in times of peace. There's nothing happening on the ground and you have the Prime Minister talking nuclear in the United Nations. So at what stage will they start yelling nuclear? That is something that nobody can predict. I personally feel that your conventional operations, as was brought out by the chief yesterday, are based on the political aim translated into the military objectives. And you must keep it at that. Deterring Pakistan or anybody else from using nuclear weapons against us is the job of the Strategic Forces Command or your nuclear deterrence. Deterrence, again, has two parts. One is the military capability. Second is the political will. So I'll take another minute. At times, Pakistan feels that earlier times, India has not taken strong actions. Whether it was 1999 Kargil, we kept it limited to an area. In 2001, Parliament attack, we did nothing. 2008, before anything could happen, we said war is no option. So obviously, they are emboldened by this, and they feel that India will not take strong action. But now things have changed. With the present government, we've done a cross-border operation in Myanmar. We've done the surgical strikes, and we raised the bar by using the Air Force to hit at enemy terrorist camps. So today you have the military capability, you have the political will, which adds on to credible deterrence against any other country. So therefore, I feel your conventional operations should be planned the way you want to do it. Leave the nuclear out of it. All I can say is that the ops rooms of the three services, the integrated defense staff, and the nuclear ops rooms are all connected in real time. So if any adjustments have to be made to your plans, they would be done in real time, and people would know as to when to pull in the reins if you actually have to do it. I stop here, but I'll just, what General AK had said at the beginning, that has the world become safer with this kind of technology? The answer is yes and no. As long as technology grows with everybody and mutual vulnerability stays, nobody will dare use nuclear weapons because everybody realizes that nuclear weapons bring only devastation. So at this stage, since 1945, for 75 years, we've not had a nuclear exchange. I personally feel with the way we are going, irrespective of who is the leader in whichever country, I think nuclear deterrence is here to stay. And for the time being, I feel we are definitely safe as a nuclear power. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Amit. Certainly, the PAK leaders are, Pakistani leaders are not so irrational as made out to be. And we have seen, despite all the rhetoric, both in the Kargil limited war as well as the recent deep airstrikes India conducted, we were able to reclaim partial conventional space. Though the form that a conventional response will take in future will have to be nuanced. And certainly, I think the world is a safe place because nobody is bothered about the nuclear threat. Everybody is worried about the coronavirus. With that, we are ready to take questions. Please, we'll take two or three questions at a time. Please be short.